as we continue our discussion as to who it is that is worthy of the office of a pastor, we really want to be careful to allow God's word to tell us who is best prepared to be a pastor. You see, Jesus took what appeared in many ways to be a bunch of ragtag, outcasts from society, and called them to be his disciples. And of course, those disciples were the apostles, the first called pastors in the church. One of those men was Matthew. Matthew was a tax collector. He collected taxes along the Roman highway at Capernaum. And we actually have a highway marker from Capernaum. And now this highway marker is from the time after Jesus. But Matthew was a guy who sat out by a highway mile marker like this, and he collected taxes from anyone that went by. Everyone that wanted to use the royal highway or the Roman road had to pay a tax. Think of it like a toll road today. And Matthew, as a tax collector, was viewed by many people around him as dishonest, as disloyal, as crooked, as greedy. You see, tax collectors had a terrible reputation, and they actually made their money on the backs of their fellow Jewish people as they collected the taxes for the Roman government. So we can think about the character of Matthew, or the perceived character of Matthew, and think someone like that, there's no way that person should be a pastor. And yet Jesus called him, and that brings us to a very important part as to who it is that should serve as a pastor. We know that all Christians are called to share forgiveness and to love one another, but pastors are called in a special way. There is an inner call. If someone wants to go to ministry, God reveals in his own special way to that person that he wants them to serve in his kingdom. And it's different for everybody who's called into ministry. You know, I've talked to one person who was literally walking out in cornfields when the Holy Spirit spoke to that person in a special and meaningful way that led them into ministry. I talked to somebody else one time who was just reading their Bible in devotions in office at work. And that was when God kind of indicated to them that they wanted them to be a pastor. So there's this call, an inner call. But for us as Lutheran Christians, particularly as Lutheran Church Missouri Synod Christians, we also believe in the formal call, the call that God issues to a person from the congregation. And on this note, especially as we talk about pastors, we want to turn to 1 Timothy chapter 3, verses 1 and 2. Here St. Paul has written, under inspiration of the Holy Spirit, "The saying is trustworthy. If anyone aspires to the office of overseer, he desires a noble task. Therefore, an overseer must be above reproach, the husband of one wife, sober-minded, self-controlled, respectable, hospitable, and able to teach. Not a drunkard, not violent but gentle, not quarrelsome, not a lover of money. He must manage his own household well and with all dignity, keeping his children submissive." And then St. Paul goes on to talk about why it is that a person must have these qualifications. He also goes on to say that it shouldn't be someone who's new to the faith. It should be somebody who has a mature faith, someone who's been a Christian for some time. Now, there are a lot of people that want to tell us that anyone that wants to be a pastor can be a pastor. But in this particular passage, one thing that is pretty clear is that in the church, that men are called to the office of pastor. Women can also be called to serve in the church. We have many women that serve in the staff of our church as teachers, in the music ministry, helping to lead worship. DCEs can be female. But when it comes to the pastoral office, particularly in our church body, we make sure that it's only men. If St. Paul wanted to say, and therefore if the Holy Spirit wanted to say through St. Paul, that men or women should serve as pastors, he could have said the husband or wife of one spouse. He didn't have to use gender-specific adjectives when talking about the qualifications for ministry. And so God, for his own purposes and for his own reason, has limited the office to men. That doesn't in any way devalue women or the role of women in the church. It just means that this is one particular way that God has set men aside to serve in his kingdom. Now, there are a lot of Christian churches that have female pastors. Are they pastors? Well, yeah, they are pastors, but but we, from our perspective, don't necessarily agree with that practice. Doesn't mean they're lesser Christians, it just means that we have a very significant departure of belief in this area, and our practice isn't the same. And so on that note, when it comes to pastors and who should be a pastor, we want to let God's word tell us who is best qualified, who is well prepared. And then we look to the call process as it is practiced and in all sorts of different ways, in all sorts of different church bodies, as the way that the Holy Spirit brings those called ministers, those called pastors to work in the kingdom. Please pray with me. Dear Father in heaven, and when it comes to matters of practice, especially as we think about the office of the holy ministry and men serving as pastors, we ask that you would help us to always find the source of our doctrine and teaching in your word, that you would help us to practice our faith as you would have it, and that you would help us all to find our place by your Holy Spirit's power in your kingdom, gladly using the gifts, the talents, and the abilities that you have blessed us with to serve you and your kingdom, knowing that you use all Christians, men and women, boys and girls, adults, children, everyone to accomplish your purpose in whatever way that they would serve in your church. And we thank you, dear Lord, for those special ministers who are called to serve as overseers, to serve as pastors. And we pray that you would bless them always to teach the truth of your word and to administer your sacraments according to your holy command. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Blessings on your day.